Good morning. It is such a delight to be here. I'm Kimberly Cole, the Reproductive Health and HIV Advisor in the Latin America and Caribbean Bureau at USAID. I first want to express my appreciation and gratitude to the Coalition for including this panel on the agenda and for giving us this opportunity here in Mexico to showcase the region's evolution of family planning to a global audience. I also want to thank Milka Dinev for helping conceptualize this panel and for her excellent leadership of the Coalition's LAC Forum. We've gathered a distinguished panel to discuss a critical set of issues that have had a tremendous impact on the health and well-being of people in Latin America and the Caribbean. Family planning for throughout this region, compared to other regions, is very strong, but it hasn't always been this way. The Latin American experience represents an outstanding success in international development, with lessons that are useful to other regions of the world. Today's conversation will share fresh perspectives on what worked in LAC that can be adapted and applied elsewhere. But we will also acknowledge the significant remaining challenges that are closely related to inequalities, and we'll discuss worrisome trends in adolescent fertility. I'm delighted to introduce Dr. Jane Bertrand, the chair of Department of Global Health Systems and Development at Tulane University. She led the measure evaluation work and research that will be presented today. Jane has worked in Latin America since the 1970s, and she also has a global perspective with special expertise in program evaluation and behavior change communication. I would like to thank Jane and her team for their remarkable dedication to this work. Also on the Tulane team, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Roberto Santiso, a medical doctor from Guatemala, who was instrumental in founding the Guatemala IPPF member association, APROFAM, and then later led it for 25 years, among his many other contributions to family planning in the region. We're going to talk about pioneers in family planning in this region, and I'm delighted to have a pioneer on this panel today. Dr. Victoria Ward is also a member of the Tulane research team. Victoria has decades of experience managing programs that address access to sexual and reproductive health, youth programming, HIV and AIDS, and abortion. Notably, she served as IPPF WHR's Director of Programs for 10 years and is currently an independent consultant. And then joining the panel is Dr. Vicente Diaz, who is the Deputy Director of IPPF WHR. He has held senior positions in the Mexico IPPF Member Association, MEXFAM, the Ministry of Health, the National Institutes of Medical Sciences, among others, with over 30 years of experience in the area of medicine, research, and management, with a focus on sexual and reproductive health. He will present the NGO's perspective of the evolution of family planning in the region. Lastly, we are joined by Mr. Jagdish Upadhyay, who leads the UNFPA Commodity Security Branch. Jagdish has over 30 years of experience in family planning, commodity security, public health policy development, social marketing, and management. We are delighted that Jagdish will share the perspectives on why the LAC experience is important for a global audience to understand. The Tulane team will first present their research, and then Vicente and Jagdish will each respond. We plan to have question and answer at the conclusion of the presentations. I now invite the Tulane team to share their work. Thank you.
Good morning. What an honor to be here to present the history of the amazingly successful family planning program in the Latin America and Caribbean region. Let me begin by saying I will speak in English, as will Victoria Ward. Roberto Santiso will speak in Spanish, so please be prepared with your earphones. I've been able to identify very few advantages of growing older. However, one of them is when you're asked to do a history of 50 years, it turns out you've lived a good part of that and experienced it firsthand. We began this assignment with four objectives: to document what have been the trends in demographic changes, contraceptive use, as well as economic and educational changes that have greatly facilitated family planning in the region. We wanted to analyze the role that governments, NGOs, donors, including USAID and UNFPA and others, have played in this. From this, we hope to gather key lessons learned, which might be applicable to other regions that are now struggling with some of the same issues. And finally, to outline some of the remaining challenges in the region. In terms of our methodology, we had three sources of information. We interviewed approximately 100 key informant interviews from government, donors, civil society, NGOs, through different periods of this 50-year history, many of whom are here in the room today. We used the literature review, both peer-reviewed and the gray literature, and we leaned on the DHS and RHS, other national surveys. Our results are or will be available through an overview, a summary report of the entire process, an executive summary, copies of which are available in English and Spanish on the table right outside this room. In addition, there are 8 case studies which will become available soon and which have formed the basis of this work. You can see them here on the list. A picture speaks 1,000 words. And in this graph, we have the trends for the total fertility rate in selected Latin American countries. The data begin in the mid-80s, which is to say the trends were even, could have represented from that period onward. This is when we began to have really good data for many countries in the region. And although we do see differences in terms of countries that still have a higher fertility rate than others, the message of this graph is the continuous, steady, declining fertility rates in country after country. We have 8 selected countries here. If we had all in the region, the lines would look exactly the same. The second graph is modern contraceptive prevalence among married women, and conversely, the graph shows this strong, steady, upward progress for countries throughout the region. There are still countries in the region that have a prevalence under 50%. That would be Haiti, Bolivia, and Guatemala. On the other hand, we applaud the achievements of countries that now have a modern contraceptive prevalence rate of 70% or above: Brazil, Colombia, Costa Rica, and Nicaragua. For those of you in the audience that are from Africa, and I know there are many, I hope that these graphs serve as some inspiration. Latin America was not always at the point it is today, and the road they have followed does provide a great motivation and inspiration to others. All is not rosy. The adolescent birth rates in the region tend to be very troublesome. 79 births per 1,000 women aged 15 to 19 represents the highest adolescent fertility of any region in the world outside of sub-Saharan Africa. Even more troubling, but not surprising, birth rates are higher among poor adolescents than among their more affluent counterparts. So for those of you, how many people live this history or parts of this history in Latin America? All right, well, so let's take a trip down memory lane. The Latin American region started, family planning movement in this region started in the mid-1960s when the International Planned Parenthood Federation performed amazing catalytic work visiting each country, identifying doctors, nurses, concerned citizens with these women who were often poor, faced with endless childbearing that was a drain on their health and a drain on their financial situation. In identifying these, they formed some of the first private family planning associations, which then became the affiliates of the IPPF. USAID established its population program in 1965 and immediately was providing technical as well as financial support to countries throughout the region. As a result, clinics, do we have a phone going here? Yes, okay. As a result, we began to see clinics opening up in urban areas. And for those of you interested in supplies, what did they have to offer? The only methods available at the time: pills, IUDs, and condoms. governments remained cautiously on the sidelines, not sure they were quite ready to take on this very sensitive issue of family planning. In the 1970s, it became evident that this medical model was not going to reach women in the rural areas and even in marginalized urban areas. And there were innovative efforts in the area of community-based distribution and contraceptive social marketing. We saw the introduction of permanent methods, including voluntary male and female sterilization. Governments began to take their role in family planning service delivery. By the 1980s, services were quite readily available in many parts of the both urban and rural areas of countries throughout the region. Multiple actors were involved. The government, IPPF, Social Security, faith-based organizations. The DHS and the RHS surveys provided excellent means of tracking what was progress in these areas and where did needs continue. Perhaps the one setback, and coincidentally we're here in Mexico City today, was the Mexico City policy, whereby the U.S. government denied funding to any private organizations in developing countries that were in any way involved in abortion. By the 1990s, there was a shift in thinking and transition toward sustainability. USAID began to phase out its funding in selected countries in the region based on countries having reached certain criteria. Fortunately, at the same time, the public sector within Latin America became much more involved in the purchase and delivery of family planning. And the entire region was marked by the 1994 Cairo conference, in which there was a shift toward sexual and reproductive health. Starting in the 2000s, there was a very strong focus in the region on contraceptive security. As USAID formalized its graduation process and more countries prepared for graduation, this idea of having sufficient stock and trained personnel to be able to monitor it became a priority in many countries. The UNFPA increased its role in the procurement of contraceptives to the great benefit of the region. Surprisingly, the public sector became the leading source of contraceptives for women throughout the region. Oftentimes, this was covered by insurance, Social Security, or other mechanisms. Which brings us to 2014. It's almost unimaginable to the folks that started the family planning movement in Latin America 50 years ago that as of today, the total fertility rate region-wide is 2.2. The percent of married women using modern contraceptives is 67%. And only two countries in the region, Guatemala and Haiti, currently continue to receive USAID bilateral family planning support. True, the issue of adolescent fertility has not been resolved. From this analysis, we felt it important to try to draw what were the key factors that underscored this amazing success in Latin America over this 50-year period. And I turn this to my colleague, Dr. Victoria Ward, to present those factors.
Buenos dias. Now I'm going to speak in English, as John has suggested. The first key factor that we identified in consultation with many of the people who are here today, who were our key informants, was the prevalence of strong NGOs and eventually women's groups. The early pioneers were enthusiastic champions, usually based in NGOs or in research organizations, although here in Mexico, many were in the public sector. These committed individuals created a real movement for family planning in the region. Eventually, alliances developed with governments and with women's groups, particularly after the ICPD conference in 1994. While NGOs no longer play the dominant role, that they once did in service provision in the region, they are still important to hold governments accountable, to innovate, and to advocate. Increased levels of literacy and urbanization have contributed to changes in family size norms and to attitudes towards contraceptive use in the region. Similarly, widespread access to radio and television, especially the popular soap operas that frequently showed smaller family sizes and dealt with themes related to unwanted pregnancies, contributed to the change in norms. In recent years, several countries have recognized the right to sexual and reproductive health in their constitutions or in legislation. No history of family planning in the region would be complete without acknowledging the role of external support to the development of robust family planning services. USAID was by far the largest donor, but UNFPA, IPPF, the PAHO, the Pan-American Health Organization, and several foundations also contributed. Graduation from USAID support was systematic and gradual in most countries. It was based on numerous indicators of country readiness and took place only after strategic investments had been made to strengthen local abilities. In most countries, committees led by government included civil society organizations and planned jointly to avoid duplication of efforts and expand coverage. In several countries, USAID created umbrella groups that were able to channel funding and technical assistance to small NGOs and community-based organizations. Some of these networks, such as PROCOSI in Bolivia and NICA Salud in Nicaragua, have continued as sustainable organizations. In many countries, multi-sectoral contraceptive security committees have been vital to advocacy efforts and to ensuring the continuity of technical support for contraceptive security as governments changed. One of the greatest legacies of USAID and other donors in the region has been the strong cadre of highly skilled professionals that were trained in a variety of key areas that are listed on the slide here. These individuals, some of them in the room, are a legacy that will continue to and has continued to increase coverage of contraceptive services after the withdrawal of USAID. Research played an important role in convincing policymakers to begin work on family planning in the region. And the family planning field in this region has been characterized by a culture of respect for data. There is widespread recognition that information, whether from large-scale surveys, operations research, information systems, or evaluations, contribute enormously to program successes. Since the 1970s, countries in the LAC region have conducted 34 demographic and health surveys and 9 reproductive health surveys. National level health surveys have continued in many countries, even after USAID withdrawal. Strategic communication activities were key to increase demand in the early years. For instance, Colombia's Pro Familia pioneered the use of radio to promote family planning as early as 1969. And in the 1970s, the Mexican government began using educational telenovelas, soap operas, and to promote family planning, resulting in measurable increases in utilization of government family planning clinics. These efforts evolved to encompass a broad array of social marketing and behavior change techniques by the 1990s. By the late 2000s, with demand already high, communication activities declined markedly in many countries. In the early years, international donors, USAID in particular, provided most of the funding for family planning in the LAC region. NGOs became sustainable as aid was withdrawn by selling a diverse range of services and developing social marketing or commercialization approaches. In some cases, they cross-subsidize, using revenues from clinics that serve clients who can pay to subsidize services for young people or for the poorer sectors of society. For governments, the health sector reforms of the last 20 years have put a premium on universal health coverage, and family planning has become one component of integrated primary health care services, rather than the vertical programs of the early years. While this poses some challenges, financing for these activities have increasingly come from traditional government revenue sources. A ninth factor for success in the region has been effective advocacy. While Latin America never had the legislation barring family planning, such as occurs in some Francophone African countries, in some cases the laws and regulations governing contraception limit access to specific groups or for specific contraceptive methods. For instance, a number of countries in the region prohibit the provision of contraceptives to minors without parental consent. And regional and voluntary surgical contraception requires husband's consent or is subject to age and parity limitations in a number of countries. In recent years, advocacy has focused on contraceptive security. In addition, national and regional coalitions have formed around specific issues such as comprehensive sexuality education, emergency contraception, and safe motherhood. Persistent attempts on the part of the Roman Catholic Church to ban modern family planning services, especially emergency contraception, have been successfully thwarted by organized advocates in many countries in the region. The tenth and final factor that we identified was contraceptive increased attention and investment in contraceptive security and with a focus on procurement and supply chain management. Currently, with the exception of Haiti, all countries in the region procure their own contraceptives. Strategies such as collecting data on the needs of marginalized groups and advocating for them have helped governments maintain commitment to providing contraceptives. In response to concerns over the potential inability of governments to meet projected needs, one strategy, which was successful, was to encourage market segmentation and strengthen the role of the private sector as well as social security institutions to provide contraceptives, thus reducing the burden for the ministries of health in the region. At this point, I'd like to invite my colleague, Roberto Santiso, to come and talk about some of the remaining challenges that we identified through this research and to discuss some of our recommendations for the future. Thank you.
Buenos días a todos. Es un placer estar compartiendo con ustedes esta importante conferencia. Ustedes han oído y las presentaciones anteriores que demuestran que la región de América Latina y el Caribe ha logrado importantes avances, pero aún quedan retos por hacer. Quizás el más importante es la fecundidad en adolescentes, una de las más altas del mundo. Esta es la única región donde se incrementó el número de embarazos en adolescentes de menores de 15 años. Y preocupa que un gran porcentaje de embarazos no deseados ocurre entre jóvenes de 15 a 19 años en esta área. Esto se debe a cosas muy conocidas, a varios factores culturales, a biológicos, ya que las y los adolescentes no tienen experiencia sobre la sexualidad. Las altas tasas de embarazo en adolescentes es un problema de salud pública para América Latina, por la gran cantidad de complicaciones que se presentan durante el embarazo y el parto. Lo principal es asegurar que todos los adolescentes menores de 19 años reciban información y tengan acceso a métodos anticonceptivos cuando los necesiten, y en condiciones que garanticen su privacidad, respeten su sexualidad como un derecho. Un segundo reto para esta región es la necesidad de fortalecer la educación integral de la sexualidad en la adolescencia. Está comprobado que la educación sexual integral es crucial para reducir los embarazos en los adolescentes y que esta resulta mucho más efectiva si se imparte a través del sistema escolar. Sin embargo, todos conocemos que esto ha sido un tema políticamente delicado por varias razones, como por rechazo de grupos religiosos conservadores que se oponen a la educación sexual escolar por considerar que es una función que corresponde a los padres de familia y a la educación religiosa. En segundo lugar, los presupuestos de los ministerios de educación del área generalmente son limitados y no dan prioridad a la sexualidad, a pesar que existen compromisos internacionales. Algunos países de la región prácticamente han eliminado la brecha en acceso a los métodos modernos por lugar de residencia urbano rural. Y esto se define a través del tercer reto, que es reducir las brechas en el acceso a la planificación familiar en las áreas rurales, pobres e indígenas. En algunos países se han eliminado las brechas en el acceso a métodos modernos por lugar de residencia, como les dije, urbano-rural. Sin embargo, esto continúa siendo un reto en todos los países con poblaciones indígenas. Otro reto importante es garantizar el apoyo continuo a la planificación familiar dentro de sistemas de salud altamente descentralizados. Uno de los beneficios de la descentralización ha sido la mayor participación local en los programas de salud. Sin embargo, preocupa a los directores de programas de planificación familiar y salud reproductiva la falta de conocimiento, la voluntad política o el interés de algunas autoridades locales hacia la planificación familiar. Todo esto puede resultar en falta de acceso a los servicios de planificación a mujeres o parejas que viven en fincas o en comunidades donde hay poco interés o hay oposición para la planificación familiar. Un quinto reto que todavía está pendiente es desarrollar competencias para la planificación familiar en el recurso humano dentro del más amplio contexto de la salud reproductiva y salud materna. La mayoría de los ministerios de salud ha continuado sus esfuerzos de capacitación en mayor o menor medida. Sin embargo, existen retos como la alta rotación de personal ya capacitado o la competencia entre otros programas de los ministerios de salud para lograr presupuestos para la misma capacitación de otras especialidades. El último reto identificado en este trabajo es garantizar la disponibilidad de información para la forma de decisiones, para la toma de decisiones en la planificación familiar. En la región persiste la falta de sistemas adecuados para recolectar datos. Su calidad no siempre es óptima y con frecuencia no se tienen datos disponibles en el momento oportuno. Aunque se tengan los datos, algunos ministerios de salud no siempre están dispuestos a compartirlos públicamente. Además, tras el retiro del apoyo financiero de USAID a la planificación familiar, algunos países han tenido dificultad para conseguir el apoyo técnico y financiero para continuar realizando sus encuestas de demografía y salud, que durante muchos años han demostrado ser valiosos para monitorear los avances en materia de salud materna y de planificación familiar. En conclusión, la historia de la planificación familiar en América Latina y el Caribe refleja logros impresionantes durante las 5 décadas pasadas. Este movimiento que empezó hace 50 años se transformó en una verdadera revolución social que fue cambiando mitos, creencias, costumbres y las leyes mismas de las sociedades. No cabe duda que esto se debe a una confluencia de factores muy importantes. A la decisión y valentía de todos los pioneros que se entregaron a esta causa con mística, más como un deber social que como un simple empleo. Estos pioneros fueron profesionales de gran prestigio, capacitadores, investigadores reconocidos de varios países latinoamericanos, como México, como Colombia, como Chile, como Perú, Brasil. Esos investigadores que fueron pioneros hicieron grandes contribuciones a la anticoncepción y a la reproducción humana. El apoyo de los gobiernos a la planificación familiar en esta área, que a medida que se fueron dando cuenta de los beneficios y de la necesidad de contar con ella, con la planificación familiar, y este ha sido un fuerte proceso progresivo de vital importancia. También a la mejora de las condiciones de vida de la población que se ha hecho evidente en América Latina en los últimos años. A los altos niveles de financiamiento externo y asistencia técnica por parte de la USAID y otros donantes importantes como la IPPF, el Fondo de Población de las Naciones Unidas, la Organización Mundial de la Salud y la Organización Panamericana de la Salud, que fueron adaptando las necesidades específicas de los países en las distintas etapas de la evolución de sus programas. A profesionales de la salud altamente comprometidos en todos los niveles del sistema de salud de América Latina. A las ONGs y a grupos de mujeres jóvenes de la sociedad civil organizada que han luchado para que la planificación familiar se reconozca como un derecho. Y esto es un derecho que las mismas mujeres han ganado contra los problemas de la inequidad de género en este continente. La fortaleza de los programas de planificación familiar, con los gobiernos haciéndose cargo ahora del papel primordial en la mayoría de los países de la región, representa uno de los mayores logros en los anales del desarrollo internacional, con lecciones que pueden resultar útiles para otras regiones del mundo. El modelo utilizado durante estos años puede servir de ejemplo para acelerar el camino a una mejor salud y el desarrollo un mejor salud y el desarrollo para la mujer y para la población en un mundo que lo está reclamando aceleradamente. A todos ellos, un reconocimiento, un agradecimiento y una solicitud sincera de seguir adelante con las nuevas estrategias que respondan a los nuevos retos que vendrán a fortalecer el desarrollo de la salud a nivel mundial. No olvidemos que tenemos un importante reto más, los adolescentes, como ustedes oyeron ya. Esos adolescentes que con confianza reflejada en sus ojos, como ustedes la pueden ver ahí, buscan nuestro apoyo, Esos ojos que tienen la confianza reflejada en nosotros. No los defraudemos. Ellos son el futuro. Muchas gracias.
We would simply like to thank all of the persons that have contributed to this analysis, to USAID, the LAC Bureau, who are our core reviewers over the past months, to over 100 key informants in the LAC region, to our colleagues in North Carolina on the Measure Evaluation Project, to our Tulane research assistants, and thanks to PhotoShare under the K4H project for the photos used herein. And of course, the final credit. Thank you.
Buenos días, bienvenidos a México. Soy mexicano, trabajando en el exterior, soy un bracero y me da mucho gusto que estén aquí reunidos. Quiero empezar esta presentación primero por agradecer la invitación para estar aquí con ustedes y segundo para reconocer que el trabajo que ha hecho USAID en el apoyo a América Latina ha sido fundamental, fundamental para el fortalecimiento de las organizaciones de la sociedad civil. Y en ese sentido voy a hablar de cuáles son los logros y los retos que tiene la sociedad civil en esta región del mundo. Yo represento a la IPPF y la IPPF es la Federación Internacional de Planificación Familiar. ¿Quiénes somos? Somos una agrupación de 152 asociaciones en el mundo, dividida en 6 regiones. Estamos en 174 países en el mundo y somos la organización más grande en nuestro tipo. Solamente semejante a la Cruz Roja Internacional, por ejemplo. Esta federación está gobernada por voluntarios, somos alrededor de 30,000 personas trabajando en el resto del mundo y nuestro foco de atención es el acceso y el ejercicio de los derechos sexuales y reproductivos de la población. Mucho se ha hecho en esta región, mucho se ha logrado, pero falta todavía mucho por hacer. Entonces, yo quiero comentar con ustedes en estos minutos cuáles son los retos que vemos como sociedad civil en esta región del mundo. Y creo que aplica también para el resto del globo. Aquí se comentaba en la mañana de la tiranía de los promedios. Yo le llamé la ilusión de los promedios. Esta es una imagen de CELAC, que es la Comisión Latinoamericana para la Economía de Naciones Unidas. Y lo que se muestra ahí es que América Latina tiene un crecimiento del 3.5% en general como Producto Interno Bruto y el Caribe el 2%. Sin embargo, lo que no considera es que el crecimiento económico no es similar al crecimiento social o al desarrollo social. Hay que hacer esa diferencia. Segundo, que el crecimiento y el desarrollo no necesariamente implica que los gobiernos ponen más dinero a los programas de salud, ¿sí? Y que no necesariamente el crecimiento económico implica una mejoría social. Y esto me llega a la segunda reflexión, que es la inequidad, la distribución de la riqueza. América Latina, desafortunadamente, es la región en el mundo con mayor desigualdad. Si nosotros analizamos lo que se conoce como el índice de Gini, que marca cuál es la diferencia entre el quintil con menor ingreso en la población y el quintil con más alto ingreso en la población, América Latina tiene la mayor desigualdad, es una desigualdad incluso mayor que el África en el subsahara. Y esto es una cosa que no se comprende completamente a través de los organismos internacionales en los donantes. La mayoría de los países en América Latina se consideran países de renta media o de ingresos medios, por lo tanto están fuera de las prioridades de los donativos y eso afecta notablemente el desarrollo de esta región. Solamente una cifra que les muestro en la parte baja de la diapositiva es que el 12% de la población en América Latina, aproximadamente 70 millones de personas, viven con menos de $2 por día de ingreso. Y esto es una cosa notable. De ahí que para la IPPF, para la sociedad civil organizada, el trabajar con las poblaciones pobres, marginalizadas y que tengan acceso a servicios es una prioridad. Aquí les muestro dos ejemplos del trabajo que hacen las asociaciones en nuestra región. En una son trabajos con grupos desplazados, y esto es Colombia, es una asociación que trabaja con los grupos que son desplazados por guerras internas, por guerrilla. Obviamente con el apoyo de USAID, ustedes ven ahí clínicas estáticas en donde las brigadas móviles los apoyan. Y del lado izquierdo de su pantalla ven una unidad móvil en Bolivia. Sí es una organización de la IPPF, proporciona estos servicios. La IPPF ha hecho un cálculo y el 77% de los clientes de la IPPF, a quienes lleva servicios, son personas pobres, marginalizadas o con falta de acceso a servicio. Esta es la misión de la Federación. Sin embargo, existe una tensión entre servir a los pobres y la sustentabilidad de las organizaciones de la sociedad civil sin fines de lucro. ¿Cuáles son algunos de los factores que producen esta tensión? Uno, que los gobiernos ahora no dan fondos no restringidos, sino que están restringidos para programas específicos, para programas verticales, y esto afecta notablemente el desarrollo de algunas organizaciones de la sociedad civil. Que algunos continentes ahora, que reconocemos que tienen necesidades mayores que América Latina, son la prioridad para recibir fondos. Esto disminuye la repartición de los recursos con el resto del mundo. Que tenemos en América Latina una filantropía apenas incipiente. Tenemos una gran riqueza en la región, sin embargo, esta riqueza está concentrada fundamentalmente en grupos conservadores, en donde la agenda liberal de salud sexual y reproductiva no es atrayente para ellos, por lo tanto, los recursos no fluyen. Y la otra cosa que ya se comentó aquí, que los gobiernos cada mes están aceptando más su responsabilidad de proporcionar servicios, los cuales serán un nicho de trabajo para las organizaciones de la sociedad civil. El otro reto que vemos en esta región y que aplica también para el resto del mundo es la gran población adolescente. El Fondo de Población de Naciones Unidas está por sacar su reporte anual, en donde comenta que el mundo está viviendo con la generación más grande de adolescentes jamás vista. Los adolescentes, por definición, no tienen acceso a la economía formal, o sea, no generan recursos económicos en ese momento, son un capital social, pero demandan educación, demandan trabajo y demandan servicios. Y estos servicios no pueden ser recuperados por cuotas. Por lo tanto, se requiere también un aporte muy importante para apoyar a esta población. También se comentó aquí que en América Latina la prevalencia de uso de métodos anticonceptivos es muy alta. Sin embargo, cuando desglosamos por diferentes sectores de la población, vemos que los y las adolescentes y la población rural son quienes tienen la mayor tasa de insatisfacción en términos de acceso a servicios. Un dato que les comento ahí, 1.2 millones de embarazos no planeados en adolescentes se dan anualmente en nuestra región. Son adolescentes que conocen de planificación familiar, que han recibido alguna información sobre distribución de métodos anticonceptivos, sin embargo no los están entendiendo. Entonces, trabajar con adolescentes es una prioridad, pero requerimos sistemas que sean cambio de actitudes. Por lo tanto, la educación sexual integral en las escuelas es una prioridad para nosotros. Y finalmente, el trabajo de advocacy. Hay que reconocer en dónde están los bloqueos a nivel de gobierno. Hay que trabajar políticamente para que estos cambios sean favorables a nuestra causa. Si queremos seguir trabajando en el marco legal, hay que influir en ese marco legal para que el marco legal nos permita trabajar. Y finalmente, estos marcos legales abren o cierran oportunidades. IPPF ha reconocido esto y tiene materiales que ponemos a su disposición para hacer mapeo político, para hacer trabajo de advocacy, para hacer seguimiento de presupuestos a nivel gubernamental, para influir en estos cambios para que sean favorables. Ya tienen un esquema de cuál sería el perfil que podemos obtener de diferentes países con respecto a las posibilidades de hacer trabajo de advocacy en nuestros gobiernos. Somos sociedad civil organizada, nuestra responsabilidad es hacer los cambios que la sociedad requiere. IPPF en ese sentido está comprometida a ser un grupo de organizaciones que trabajen unidas en favor de la salud sexual y reproductiva, que garanticen acceso universal a salud sexual y reproductiva y que trabaje de una manera organizada, con transparencia y con rendición de cuentas. Muchas gracias.
I have a short presentation. Greetings, good morning, and thank you for a very comprehensive presentation. First of all, I would like to congratulate this region for a great progress made in the last 50 years in many economic and social development fronts, particularly for many of us who started our career in family planning or social marketing. Many years ago, we learned great lessons and successes from this region. So thank you for pioneering in many of these challenging but important areas such as sexual and reproductive health, family planning, rights, women empowerment, and others, where we still have to go a long way in many other countries and regions. It is in that context of policy work that it may not be a coincidence that 8 of the countries in this region where women went to the level of presidency. Your work in health sector reform, education sector, making free education is bringing dividends. So thank you and congratulations. Now let me come back to the issue of family planning. The discourse should not always be focused on the targets and numbers, CPR and TFR. Because CPR does not talk about below 15 years and single mothers. There is some estimation that I was told that 12 to 44% premarital sex happens before 16 years of age. Also, an increased percentage of single mothers are giving births. Since 1970, this percentage increased from 17% to something like 40% now. What we have to talk about is how the youth can have choice and skills so that they can go to school, get required education, and fully participate in economic development. This way, countries have lesser economic dependent population, and that's what it is called demographic dividends. By giving choice, giving opportunities, so that they are less dependent. We have example from many countries which have already made tremendous progress by adopting such policies. We believe that youth and adolescents, particularly young girls, should be a target for development. We have to look at the out-of-pocket expenses, which I was told is highest in among the regions in the world. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have heard many times this expression, and particularly today I heard about tyranny of averages. It is not about national averages, but inclusion, equality, empowerment, and accountability that have to be emphasized. I'm so happy that all partners, particularly USAID and other bilaterals, civil society, WHO, PAHO, and other NGO and many other organizations, and my own organization, United Nations Population Fund, UNFPA, are working together in advancing reproductive health, family planning, commodity security in this region. UNFPA contributions are concrete. Almost all the countries in the region have adopted sexual and reproductive health policy. Many countries have increased their support and budget to family planning commodities, as we heard. And I was told in 1926, when the program that I particularly manage, which is called Global Program for Reproductive Health Commodity Security, GPRSCS, when we started focus work in Nicaragua, government expenditure was something like $9,000. Now in 2013, it has reached to $750,000. That's a great progress. So to thank you for taking such big responsibility. Another good example is UNFP has provided RS commodities in the amount of $104 million from 2008 to 2013, and out of which something like $46 million is third-party procurement. What that means is governments have bought from their own resources. You know, the being dependent and asking for donation is one thing. Being sustainable, using their own fund, putting the budget line and buying that, that's what we call the great success in increasing their resources. The focus work of GPRACS in many innovative and sustainable efforts are truly bringing changes in the region. Strategic targeted support has helped get RACS priority in the national agenda in many countries, including Haiti, Dominican Republic, and many other Caribbean countries, Honduras, Nicaragua, El Salvador, Panama, Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, and Uruguay, and many other countries. Our effort to build logistics and supply chain management is making progress. I'm told that many countries where we did survey, stock out is really reducing. Our work with civil society is really bringing good results. They are the vanguard to raise the accountability to the public sector. So again, congratulations to IPPF and all other civil societies who are present in this room. The priority for this region is therefore, in our view, that we need to continue advocate to remove the regularity barriers to access to contraceptive by adolescents and youth, including comprehensive sexuality education. In particular, this advocacy effort needs to focus on engaging with national and local governments to reduce legal and financial barriers and expand access to modern contraceptives for all. We need to work more to narrow the disparities within the region and within the countries regarding access to information, services, and supplies, particularly for indigenous and other marginalized population. We need to review the issues of decentralization, and there are good examples given by earlier presenters that how it impacts on contraceptive procurement. And this is something that civil society and all our partners are working together. And advocate for predictable and sustainable and long-term resource flow to meet the need of RS commodities, because that's one of the areas that identified by the presentation, because it fluctuates and it is making a big difference. And finally, we need to broaden the choice of method mix that meet the requirement of different population, including young people and adolescents. At last, I want to call on you to say that consistent availability of modern contraceptive is a national security issue, and we should talk about it. With this note, I again congratulate the region and presentation in the panel, and I wish my and my organization best to all of you. Thank you.
We will now open the forum for questions. Please, if you want to do the question in your own language, and if there's any need for translation, I will be doing it. Vamos a abrir el foro a las preguntas. Si hay alguna pregunta, por favor, háganla en su propio idioma y con mucho gusto se las traduciremos aquí, si es necesario. Any questions?
Seria Galván, de República Dominicana. A mí me gustaría, felicitaciones al panel, y un punto que me gustaría destacar es el impacto de la violencia contra las mujeres y las niñas en el acceso a métodos anticonceptivos y a servicios de salud sexual y salud reproductiva. Y me gustaría, si los panelistas pudieran referirse también a ese tema como un elemento crucial en América Latina y el Caribe para el acceso a servicios de salud sexual y reproductiva.
Okay, Silvia Galván from the Dominican Republic. She wants to congratulate the panel. And also, she would like the panel to address the issue of violence being exerted against women in the access to contraceptive and reproductive health supplies as a major factor in the region. Would you like, podemos tener otras dos preguntas para que mientras vayan pensando nuestros panelistas. Two other questions maybe for our
I
I think if they are talking the overall gender-based violence, then it's the important issue that we, I think everybody raised that issue, and that we need to deal with in terms of sex, and everybody talk about sexuality education, and education particularly for young people and adolescents. So this is important, and we believe, I believe that everybody spoke about sexuality education and why it is important. And gender-based violence is something that we all condemn. So I don't know if there is a specific question to anyone, and if somebody wants to talk.
Creo que es una pregunta extremadamente relevante. Yo le diría dos aspectos los se puede trabajar. Uno es, son las leyes en los países. Hay muchas leyes restrictivas que no permiten ese tipo de intervenciones. Hay que trabajar, hay que hacer advocacy para que esto sea abierto, discutido y sea legalmente posible. Y lo segundo es trabajar con prestadores de servicios para tener una detección temprana y un tratamiento oportuno y prevención de estos problemas.
Okay, next question.
Emma Iriarte, del Banco Interamericano de Desarrollo.
¿Puede hablar un poquito más alto, por favor? Gracias.
Emma Iriarte, del Banco Interamericano de Desarrollo. Me ha gustado mucho ver todo el tema de los retos y de los factores de éxito en América Latina y el gran trabajo que todos los países en esta región han hecho. Me gustaría pedir al panel algún comentario en relación que, si bien hemos alcanzado grandes logros, sobre todo en la tasa de uso, a pesar de los promedios y de los problemas todavía en el quintil de mayor pobreza, algunos comentarios en relación a la calidad de servicio, que tienen que ver en función, que eso escuché muy poco en la discusión, en relación a la atención diferenciada, en relación a estándares que debemos cumplir, no solamente en la aplicación o en el uso del método mismo, sino en servicios de consejería. Y también en los temas de adaptación cultural de servicios, cuando estamos hablando que hay poblaciones de las más pobres que están referidas a mujeres indígenas, adolescentes y áreas rurales. Gracias.
Okay. She would like the panel to address the issue of quality in the services, particularly the part where of cultural adaptation, counseling, not just access, but what needs to be done about counseling, cultural adaptation, especially in the case of indigenous women, for example.
Esta situación de la calidad de servicios es una preocupación muy grande en el área. La atención de servicios no solo se refiere al desempeño personal, sino a todo un entorno que garantiza el servicio. Y puede usted tener muy buenos servidores, pero si no tiene facilidades de estructura y de facilidades de este transporte, etcétera, la calidad de servicio se ve muy disminuida. Y esta es una de las grandes preocupaciones para América Latina, porque además en esta calidad de servicios se refleja que hay una deficiencia de personal para prestar los servicios de planificación familiar. Muchos países tienen hasta un déficit de los estándares internacionales, que llegan al 30 o 40%. Es difícil, y esta es una de las grandes preocupaciones que hay. Hay que mejorar los estándares de servicio y hay que mejorar las condiciones de servicio en los que se desempeña el personal. Este es uno de los retos importantes para el futuro.
Okay, we have we have 5 minutes and lots of questions, but we'll take yes, please.
Yes, I'd like to comment on the second point. Is this working?
Hola. Okay. I'd like to comment on the second point, which we do go into more detail in the research, around cultural adaptation. Throughout the region, one of the findings is that, as Roberto Santiso mentioned, there are still huge gaps when it comes to serving indigenous populations. And I think that it is very related to the issue of quality of care. And there's a real need for cultural adaptation, And a lot of times there's a real need for understanding and dialogue between the service providers, between politicians and indigenous peoples. And it's one of the areas which we identified in the paper as needing considerable work in the future in the region. Thank you.
Okay. Tenemos 7 minutos más. 2 preguntas. And we have 7 more minutes, 2 more questions, but we encourage you to, we have a networking room out there, and you can always approach the panelists individually if you have any other questions. The microphone is not working. El micrófono no funciona.
So good morning, Fatima Tassi. I'm for the Ouagadougou partnership in the West Africa region to reposition family planning in that part of the world. I was very, very impressed by what I have heard about, you know, the Latin American region in terms of contraceptive prevalence rate, 50% to 70%, while in the West Africa region, in most of our countries, we are around 10% to 12%. So I was also carefully listening to the key success factors, you know, that lead to this big jump or achievement in this region, in the Latin American region. So my question is to Jagdish and Jane, knowing that how well they know also the West Africa region. What can we take as lessons? What are among the key factors, success factors that have been explained here, we could take in our region to also, you know, go with this big change or improvement? So my question is to you too. What could we do in the West Africa region to also, you know, improve substantially the contraceptive prevalence rate in this region? Thank you.
Fatima, this is a good question. And when I was speaking, I was thinking West Africa in my back of my mind. I think the success as presented here, which I was learning myself, is so much of political commitment, political willingness. From very early days, 50 years ago, you saw the picture, how much there was commitment for taking family planning, sexual and reproductive health. I gave example of 8 women presidents. You know, the whole movement of sexual reproductive health, women right issues, and family planning was from very beginning, it really helped this region. And that kind of political commitment we need in many parts of West Africa. Second is civil society is very strong in this region, and they do lots of advocacy work, and we are so proud to be a part of civil society here, because the accountability to the public sector come from the voice of the civil society, and that we need to create in that part of the world. Third is obviously economic development and resource allocation, where we need to have some more sustainable approach in that region so that we can have the same level of economic development and, you know, the way allocation is going on. And also, they were also pioneer in many innovative ideas like social marketing. I learned pro familia when I was a student in family planning, when I was starting my career. There were so many great successes and innovative ideas that come from this region. And we need to be, we can adopt that in that part of the world. But I think, again, I will emphasize that we should not look at only national averages. I think with the national averages, sometimes middle income country, they come into the trap of their own success. We need to disintegrate the data, see that where is the problem, so that we don't repeat the same thing, going to the marginalized population, young people not included, and they have no access to contraceptives. So I think some of that lessons will be important to take it, and some of the problem that we are facing in this region should be avoided if we go to adopt some of those things in that region.